Hello everyone, my name is Brian McInerney, hydrologist with the National Weather Service located in Salt Lake City, Utah. This is the extended Utah water supply briefing for January 7th. It's more for more of the engineers and people in the water community. So what we're looking at here are the winds at about 11,500 feet, and you can see the main energy of the atmosphere is moving up and around and through the Midwest and down on the East Coast. And if you look in our area on the West Coast and Western US, we see this big high pressure rotating clockwise. This is the reason why we have an inverted air mass, we have high pressure, we have very bad air in the valleys. And it's because we're basically stagnant. We don't really have any flow moving through the area. Hopefully, the Monday, Tuesday timeframe will change this and we'll see a bit of energy move our way and move this high pressure out of the way. So let's take a look at 2004 and talk about the climate we saw there. The big thing that jumps out, and this is at Salt Lake City, is 2014 ranked as the third warmest year on record in Salt Lake City, and that goes back to 1874. So it was quite warm. We had total precipitation of about 14.5 inches, where typically we get about 16. So we were close with precip, but a very, very warm and somewhat dry period. The precip anomaly starting at the water year in October, what we see is that in October, things were quite dry, extending all throughout the desert southwest in Utah. Cooler colors on this map indicate above normal precipitation anomaly. Warmer colors indicate below normal. And you can see the Pacific Northwest did well, you know, parts of Tennessee did well, but the desert southwest, including Utah, did not do very well. We were less than 25% during October. When you move to November, things were still pretty grim, a little bit better. Montana, Wyoming, but still Utah, desert southwest, not doing well at all in November. And then December hit, and we had a couple of very good storms. The first storm came in mid-December, and it rained below 7,500. Unfortunately, with that storm, we could have used that rainfall in the form of snow still stored in the mountains, but we didn't. We had it above 7,500 feet. And then the next storm came about Christmas, and it was very cold, and we had a lot of moisture really through about two-thirds of the state. Now let's take a look at temperature anomalies. And what we see starting in October had half of the US very warm, with the upper Midwest normal to cooler. And then we moved into November. Again, the desert southwest to western US generally warmer than normal, while two-thirds of the country were cooler than normal, with the upper Midwest and really the Midwest being cooler. And then we moved into December, and the entire country was above normal. And this for Utah broke out around Christmas time when it got very cold for a brief period. But the first 9 days of December, we set records for the hottest December ever recorded in Salt Lake City for the first 9 days, and that goes back to 1874. Current snowpack conditions, when we start up in the Bear, what we're seeing is 98%, and what we're looking at is the blue line is the median from 1981 to 2010. 2014 is the green line, that was last year, and 2015 is where we are today. And like I said, the Bear is at 98%, 93% for the Weber. The Six Creeks, which are the mountains to the east of Salt Lake County, at 90%. 110% for Utah Lake Drainage, actually doing quite well. The Duchesne, 101%. The green above Flaming Gorge, and this is mimicking what we saw last year. The Great Basin, not doing so well. You move up to the upper green, and we're at 133%. And you can see how big it went last year, you know, right around beginning of February for the green. And then we move into the Colorado area above Cisco as it comes into Utah, and they're currently at 109%. And then when you move over into the severe, we start seeing numbers that are about 102% for the severe. And then when you see the Virgin, not very well at all, and this mimics the last 4 years. Last year, December 8th was the last storm system they saw for the entire winter, and then into the spring until the monsoon hit. So we're showing more dry signs for the Virgin. Hopefully that will change around. Now let's take a look at water supply. And we'll start with the Bear River drainage located in this position here. We'll kind of drop down and we're going to look at two points. Now, the first is at Bear Woodruff Narrows Reservoir, and that's at 87% of average. And you can see the 10 and 90 range based on what kind of weather we have from here on out. And this is the forecast for the volume of water to come out of the mountains from April 1st through the end of July. And you can see there's still a pretty good range between what the possibilities are, the 90th percentile or the chance we could be on the 10th percentile, depending on the different outcomes in the weather. And we'll see this graphic all the way through. Then we look at Stewart Dam. They're at forecaster for 56% of average. Not very well for this area, and that's unfortunate. So when we drop down and we'll look at the Weber Basin in this area here, what we're looking at is the Weber at Oakley to start with at 91% of average, and then we're going to move over to the East Canyon area, and that's at 71% of average. Then we'll move up into Pine View, and that's at 67% of average. Dropping down south into the Six Creeks area, again, this is off of Salt Lake County. The first area we'll look at is Little Cottonwood, and they're at 87% of average forecasted at this time. Then we move up into City Creek, which is a little bit lower elevation watershed. And you can see that the numbers for the lower elevation watersheds are all quite low, and that's due to the only two really good storms hit in December. One was rain below 7,500, so that reflects the absence of snowpack in this area. So now we'll drop down once again into Utah Lake area. And the first one we take a look at is the Provo near Woodland up above Jordan L Reservoir, forecasted to produce 97% of average, which is actually quite good for this point. And then we look at the Spanish Fork near Castilla at 54% average. And again, this is due to dry soils in this area and the lack of snowpack. Moving over to the Duchesne, what we see are three points. And we'll start with Strawberry Reservoir near Soldier Springs as it comes through there. 76% of average forecasted for this point. Then we move over to the Duchesne near Tabiona Headwater area, 90% of average, looking okay. And then Knight's Diversion at 86% of average for this point. So overall, Duchesne, not so bad. We could do better in Strawberry, but we'll take what we get. Now we'll move up into the upper Green and the Green itself, which is quite healthy as it was last year. We look at the drainage above Flaming Gorge. We're seeing 102% of average, quite nice to see, with a big range depending on what happens before that. After that. The Green River downstream in the town of Green River, 95% of average, and that also takes into account the Duchesne and little bits of the Colorado. And now what we're going to do is slide down into the Lake Powell drainage. And this is a great deal of input from Colorado and the Green itself. And when you look at it before Cisco, before it even gets into Utah, we're looking at 98% of average coming out of Colorado. And then we get down to Lake Powell itself at 91% of average. So looking good for this area here. Now we'll slide over to the Sevier River drainage. And things aren't as nice as what we just saw in Colorado. When we start at the headwater areas at Sevier at Hatch, 52% of average, not so good. Last year they had a very bad year also. And then we move downstream, which is actually flowing north, the Sevier near Paiute Reservoir in the town of Marysvale at 58% of average. So the Sevier really not doing too well at this point. And then we move down into the Virgin River drainage, which has had a really bad time of things water supply wise. When we look in the headwaters of the Virgin, we see 59% of average forecasted for the Virgin. This is unfortunate as they've had a very tough time as of late. Virgin near Littlefield at 43% of average. So there you have it. There's the water supply conditions. If you would like to see anything additional in this briefing, any other way to package the data, any other types of data, give me a call. There's my phone number, or drop me an email. Otherwise, hopefully we'll get some more storms and snow, and hopefully we can pump these numbers up. And I do appreciate time take to listen to this. This is Brian McInerney. Until the next one, we'll talk to you later. See ya.